We begin our worship service by acknowledging the territory where most of us gather and where I am located. We acknowledge that we are gathered on the unceded traditional territory of the Algonquin Anishinaabe First Nation. We pay respect to the elders past and present and honor all Indigenous peoples' reverence of this land throughout the ages. May we live in peace and friendship to sustain the earth and all its people. Thank you for permitting us to live and work on this land. Good day, everyone. On behalf of Bell's Corners United Church, I welcome and greet you in the name of Jesus Christ on this third Sunday in Lent and the celebration of International Women's Day. We are also gathering for our annual general meeting today, March the 7th. At 11 in the morning via Zoom. For those of you who wish to join the meeting via telephone, the phone numbers with the meeting ID and passcode were included in the invitation that were emailed to everyone. Since Ottawa is in the orange zone, we are able to gather in the sanctuary for a modified worship service at 10 in the morning, with a maximum number of 28 people invited to gather. The public health strongly recommends to stay at home, but if you wish to attend, please call the office to register and be reminded that the usual health protocols will be in place, which include masking, social distancing, hand sanitizing, and staying home if you are unwell. For those of you who are attending the on-site worship today, there is an opportunity for you to attend the AGM. Our music director, Abe, will be on site to facilitate your participation. We continue to offer our worship service in a number of ways. Check our website at bcuc.org for our worship service in audio, video, and text formats, along with the weekly announcements, Sunday school resources, online meetings, and other updates. You can also listen to our service via telephone by dialing 613-820-8104. And please continue to reach out by connecting with each other through emails, phone calls, or prayers. If you would like your favorite hymn sung in memory of a loved one or in celebration of a joyful occasion, please let the office know. With a suggested minimum donation of $30, your hymn request will be featured in one of the Sunday services from March 14 until the 23rd. Proceeds from this fundraising will help enhance our worship experience. Please send your name, hymn request, and dedication to the office via email. Donations can be made by e-transfer, cash, or check payable to BCUC with the note, Hymn Sing. Thank you for supporting this initiative. And now for our Lenten Appeal 2021. This year, the SOSA Committee has chosen to help people from the social housing neighborhoods of West Ottawa to experience a weekend at Camp Otterdale. Participants will be contributing, but they will also need a sponsorship of $50 per person. Please consider how you can help an individual or a family to experience a much-needed break this summer. You can send in your donation via cash or by check, payable to BCUC, or by e-transfer with the note Lenten Appeal 2021. Please call the office for more details. I also invite you to participate in the prayer circle every Wednesday at 8 p.m. Wherever you are, you may light a candle and say a prayer for the world, your community, including our congregation, your family, your loved ones and friends, and of course, for yourself. And due to the annual general meeting taking place after the service today, there will be no Zoom fellowship, but we will resume our fellowship next Sunday, March the 14th. And for all other announcements, please visit the website. Friends, in this season of Lent, we know what God desires for us, that we do justice and love kindness and walk humbly with God. We gather this morning to remind each other about that, to remember that now is always the right time to do these things. So with thanks in our hearts, let us worship God.
Light and warmth are returning to the land wherever we are. Light and warmth are represented in the light of Christ that glows from this flame. May the symbol of this lit candle remind us of the reality of the land and the light and the warmth of our presence with God.
Please join me in the call to gather. On this annual general meeting Sunday, we are summoned here by our holy God, who calls us each by name and gathers us together in the unity of Jesus Christ. Young and old and middle-aged, individuals and families, soft-spoken and outspoken, we hear our names being called to join in worship. This sanctuary of love is a place to pursue God's vision for all people, unity and joy and faith expressed through different gifts. Let us worship together.
Please join me in the prayer of confession. Gracious God, we confess that we do not always follow your will. We do not reach out to those in need because we see no connection between their need and our faith. We have often failed to listen to your whispers, which call us to build a community where freedom, equality, and dignity for all, especially women, are assured. Forgive us. Restore us. Open our eyes to your truth. Amen. I now invite you to take a moment of silence. And hear now the words of God's assurance. As we walk with God, we are transformed day by day. God's never-ending love journeys with us, making us new again and again. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Story from love.
What makes you really mad or upset? Are you okay with your siblings playing with your stuffies? As long as they stay away from your very special teddy that you sleep with, that's taking it too far. Maybe you don't mind too much if your sister borrows your bike, but when it comes back scratched, that's too far. Maybe you're fine with some teasing or smack talk on the soccer field, but when it comes to some pushing and shoving, that's not cool. What is just not okay with you? Where do you draw the line? In our Bible passage today, we hear about a time when Jesus saw that things were just not okay and lost it on the people at the temple in Jerusalem. The merchants who were there selling animals were overcharging, and the money changers were cheating people. They were taking advantage of the people who had come to the city to celebrate Passover. Seeing all of this, Jesus decided, I guess, that it wasn't enough to do what he was usually doing, modeling how to love one another, welcoming the outcasts, healing and teaching about God's love. Nope, this went too far. He went in and started throwing things around and yelling at people. Stop! God's house is not for making money. This is a holy place for the Jewish people to come and feel one with God and to refocus themselves on their faith. This is not okay. I wonder, what would Jesus get super upset about nowadays? What issues would Jesus get so riled up about that he'd start throwing stuff around and yelling? This week, we celebrate International Women's Day. I wonder what modern-day Jesus would say about women's rights. This is a great time to recognize the accomplishments that women have made, to celebrate progress and lift up inspirational women so they can be role models for young people around the world. But it's supposed to be more than just a time to say, thanks, women. It's a time for all of us to remember to not just be thankful for what's been done, but like Jesus, to remember to put our foot down and say, no, it's not okay when we see things that aren't fair or right, like rude name calling or treating girls like they're less able than boys, or when girls aren't given equal opportunities to boys. And to remember to really do something about it and make a change. I'm sure there are other issues that really bother you too. When Greta Thunberg saw how climate change was not being taken seriously, she got mad and did something about it. When Malala saw that girls' education rights were not being upheld, she got mad and did something about it. Now, it might seem hard and you're just a kid, but you can do it. Like Jesus showed us, it's okay to get mad sometimes if you're getting mad about something really important. You can stand up for those you see or hear who are not being treated right. You can start by saying, no, that's not okay. Let's have a little prayer. Dear God, thank you for the story about Jesus and how he taught us about a good kind of anger. Make us brave to stand up for those who need help. Teach us to say, no, that's not okay, and do something about it with love and fairness. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh God, send out your spirit, renew the face of the earth. Oh God, send out your spirit, renew the face of the earth. Every time a person reaching out is turned away by the racist, prejudicial attitudes of hate, we are called to break the silence, sanctioning the shame, stepping across the lines of this sometimes unholy game. Send out your oppression that we haven't really faced. Human inhumanity upon the human race. Spirit ever faithful, spirit ever true. Ring down all around in every lunge we move.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. God of the Scripture, may your word grant us courage and conviction to listen and to act in faith. Amen. The reading for today is taken from the Gospel according to John, chapter 2, verses 13 to 22, and I'm reading from the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible. Jesus cleanses the temple. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years. And you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. May the light of Christ dwell where the word is spoken. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Let my words speak God's truth, and may they move each listener's heart. Amen. A man by the name of Theo spent 3 years working in the poor sector of an urban city. He was confronted with issues of poverty, homelessness, addiction, racism, sexism, and the misery of people who live in desperate situations. One day, Theo decided that he was going to go to a theological college to be a minister. The church board asked him to be interviewed by the Regional Council Education and Students Committee. On his interview day, the chair asked him, "Theo, what is your call?" And he replied, "Outrage." The chair responded, No, what's your real call?" And again, Theo replied, "Outrage." For most Christians, being angry, especially in church, is not acceptable. We were taught, even at a young age, that anger is the very opposite of the virtues of love, patience, gentleness, and forgiveness. Some of us have great difficulty with the idea of an angry, wrathful, violent God depicted in the Hebrew Scripture. And if we have difficulty with the idea of an angry God, it is even more ludicrous for us to think of Jesus as someone who lost his temper in an angry fit. Over the centuries, artistic depictions of Jesus were intentionally devoid of humor or negative emotions such as anger. They were usually somber, serious, and solemn. Jesus praying in the garden, Jesus holding the little lamb, Jesus knocking on the door, to name a few. So when we encounter an angry Jesus in our gospel story today with some kind of a temple tantrum, as Lori puts it, when he overturns the tables and driven out the money changers and animal vendors, we were overwhelmed. We were surprised, shocked, with a possible reaction of, I can't believe Jesus could have done this. After all, we were taught that Jesus was supposed to be meek and mild, soft-spoken, kind and gentle. He taught us to turn the other cheek and love even our enemies. To be honest, I feel a sense of relief when I hear this particular story in John. For here is Jesus reacting as anyone might react in a situation where justice is the demand of the day and requires something must be done rather than being silent. Jesus was outraged. And this story makes me say, Bravo, Jesus! You are human like us after all. This passage known as Jesus Cleanses the Temple is, I think, a misrepresented title. The truth is, it is about anger. According to Jan Pound, a holy and righteous anger. That was Jesus' motivation for his action. It was this prophetic side of Jesus that compelled him to claim his values and live them out, thus making it a very powerful story. Jesus' disruption that day in the temple was a sign of Jesus' disagreement of the way things were. But what made Jesus angry, you may ask? Didn't he realize that when he entered Jerusalem, it was the holiest time of the year for the Jewish people? It was the Passover festival, which drew thousands of Jewish people, pilgrims, to pay their homage in the temple. People in the temple courts were only doing what was required of them to do under Jewish law. They were buying and selling animals for the purpose of offering God a sacrifice in the temple. It was inconvenient for the pilgrims to bring their own animal sacrifices as they traveled from far distance for the Passover. The money changers were there. They were necessary because people couldn't use the Roman money, which had the inscription of the emperor on it. They needed to change the Roman currency for the Jewish shekel, which was used to support the temple priests as well as the maintenance of the temple with the temple tax. So, what made Jesus angry? In spite of the temple priests burning incense and other scented elements, nothing could mask the stench of slaughter and blood. Jesus' anger fuels his actions. As a social prophet, he then proceeds to make his political and religious statements. As Riza Aslan states in his book Zealot, think of the temple as a kind of feudal state employing thousands of priests, singers, porters, servants, and ministers while maintaining vast tracts of fertile land tilled by temple slaves on behalf of the high priest and for his benefit. If one looks at the temple tax along with the profits made from the money changers, which enabled the temple to take a cut, it is easy to catch a glimpse of just how threatening Jesus was to the whole system. Remember the Reformation father, Martin Luther, who nailed the 95 theses against the corruption of the Catholic Church in the 16th century? Of how he was outraged of the indulgences people have to pay in order for them or their loved ones to go to heaven or be spared from going to purgatory or hell when they die? So if you are still thinking, what made Jesus angry? Here is a good answer. Because the people had lost the original sense of what the temple stood for. The people had lost the original sense of what the temple stood for. According to two well-known New Testament scholars, Marcus Borg and John Dominic Crossan, the temple developed a theology connecting this world to its source in God. As the mediator of forgiveness and purification, the temple mediated access to God and became a center of devotion. This was what the temple originally stood for, a center of devotion. When Jerusalem fell into the hands of the Roman Empire in 63 before Common Era, Rome ruled through the high priest, the temple, and a local elite group, mostly wealthy patrons. With Herod's power, the temple became the center of a domination system that oppresses the people, ruled by a few, economic exploitation, and religious legitimation. A very angry Jesus drove them out, overturned tables with a whip of cords because he objected to the outward show of loyalty to Rome or offering animal sacrifice without the corresponding purity of heart. The temple for Jesus represented Israel's identity and spiritual dignity. It was not merely a place to worship, but a powerful, proud symbol of the spiritual and physical existence of the people. Now it became a marketplace, a consumer's paradise, devoid of any pure intent of worshiping God. It is no wonder that Jesus came up with the kind of righteous anger he expressed. It was an appropriate response to the presence of injustice boiling in the heart of Jesus. Like Jesus, can we be justified in our righteous anger? I think of those protesters who voiced their grievances to then U.S. President Donald Trump and his cohorts against immigrant children being detained and separated from their parents and families. What about those who were angry because of what this pandemic has brought to them? COVID-19 illness in large proportion, death of loved ones, the rise of mental health issues, unemployment, and sense of fear and hopelessness. What about the anger displayed by those seeking justice for murdered indigenous and black people? Do they have the right to their anger and to expressing it in ways they do? What about the people of Myanmar, Hong Kong, and Belarus? Do they have the right to march on the streets in an outrage protest because of human rights violations and murder of innocent people? What about us here in church? When we display our remorse, perhaps disagreements over some issues, do we have the right to express anger despite the fact that we have been taught to be nice and loving? And what about the display of anger by women of the Democratic Republic of Congo and other places in Africa, when women and young girls were targets of violent rape and school girls were taken and used as sexual slaves? Ought women not to display such emotion because anger makes them wild and unchristian? How then should women defend themselves? Beverly Wildung Harrison wrote an essay about the power of anger, and this is what she says. Where anger rises, there the energy to act is present. We must never lose touch with the fact that all serious moral activity, especially action for social change, takes its bearings from the rising power of human anger. Such anger is a signal that change is called for, that transformation in relation is required. I strongly believe that Jesus, as a social prophet, taught us that anger for anger's sake is worthless. But anger, if it is holy and righteous and motivates us in the name of justice, love, and compassion, is a valuable expression of our hope for a new, whole, and healed community of God's people. Jesus' display of anger was a holy and righteous response because he was one whose whole being is illuminated in God's light, and who therefore naturally acts with justice and compassion. When we are angry as a righteous response to evil or injustice, then anger, for me, may become the work of liberating grace in our relationships and in our relation to the injustices of the world. Viktor Frankl says it powerfully, that those who must shed light must endure burning with passion fueled by a righteous anger. When asked to justify his violent actions with a sign, Jesus responded with an enigmatic aphorism: "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days." Now, traditional interpretations taught us that he was talking about the new temple, his own body, which will be killed, but will rise again in 3 days. But here's another way of looking at this text. God chose to localize love and justice in a human body. John's theology of an incarnated God is very present here. God becoming human through Jesus leads us to profess that the new temple is not made of bricks and mortar, but one with flesh and blood. The Reverend Dr. Peter Samuelson inspires us with his words: "Jesus came to not just destroy the temples we build to serve ourselves, but to raise up a new temple for us. A temple in which we can truly be reconciled to God. God's divine love lives in each of us through the grace which is extended to us today, even as that grace blessed the righteous, angry Jesus as he turned over the tables for the sake of justice and compassion." So friends, on this annual general meeting, when we gather as the body of Christ, remember that we are called to embody God's love, compassion, and justice in those places we are called to be. So be bold, be vigilant, express your righteous anger, and make the world tremble with love, with compassion, and with justice. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us gather our hearts in prayer. Let us pray. Good caring presence within us, around us, and above us, hold us in a sense of mystery and wonder. Let the fullness of your goodness inspire and empower us in our daily living. Let the world know your ways of caring, justice, and compassion through us. As Jesus have modeled for us in today's gospel story, let righteous and holy anger help us connect with the world, especially in those places that need healing. O God of hope, on this our annual general meeting, give our church vision, commitment, and passion for your love and justice. Strengthen our ministries, our leaders, our volunteers, our life together as a faith community. Bless all of our dreams in bringing about transformed lives and healed relationships. Instill in us your spirit of compassion so that we can share your message of abundance with others. As a compassionate community, we continue to pray for our sisters and brothers who long to seek recovery from illness, for comfort, and for wellness. We pray for those who have lost their way, for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. And we pray for those who know loneliness, want, or fear. And now in silence, we pray for those we name in our hearts. On this celebration of International Women's Day, we pause and pray for all women in the world to reclaim their voices against all kinds of issues that dehumanize them. Acts of injustice, domestic violence, poverty, lack of education, human rights violations, unemployment, rape, wars, to name a few. Remind us that the challenged world is an alert world, and from challenge comes change. Help us forge a gender equal world by celebrating women and their achievements, by raising awareness against bias, and by being an advocate for equality. Dear God, you call us into a journey of faith. With you as our strength and with the light of your love, and the knowledge that you're always with us, we can strive to do your work and attain wholeness. We pray for our world, which teeters on the challenges of the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic. Give us leaders who are less interested in being more powerful and more interested in being caring and doing the right thing. We pray for ourselves. Help us not to forget your ways. Let us walk with you. Incline our hearts to your steadfast and upright understanding. May we treasure your words in our hearts in whatever we say and do, so that our lives may reflect your way of light and love to others. All these we ask in the name of Jesus, who taught his disciples this prayer we now recite together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Holy Scripture contains stories about God's own generosity. We are recipients of the gifts of a beautiful creation, the good green earth, and all living things that live here with us. On this winter morning, we come together to thank God and to offer our gifts, so that the ministry of this church will continue to grow and be a blessing to the world. I now invite you to offer your gifts of time, talents, and resources as expressions of your gratitude to God's blessings. If you are not on par and wish to send in your offering and donations, please drop them off at the slot by the kitchen door of the church or mail them to BCUC. You can also send in your support through e-transfer. Thank you for your continued love and support to Bell's Corners United Church. Let us pray. O God, we have learned that when we give away, we are enriched, and when we let go, we receive. Bless what we give and let go this day. Amen. And now receive God's blessings. As we leave this place, God says to you and me, I am with you. I hold you. I care for you. I am on this journey with you. My steadfast love is always with you. Go in peace. This is Lent. This is the journey. Amen.